well. Thank you for joining us here at VegFest, Daryl. We really appreciate it. And it's really a pleasure for me to have her here because in my own path to a vegan lifestyle, I came through the environment 26 years ago. And incidentally, I consider it one of the best decisions of my life. If anyone is curious around all of that, I'll be happy to talk with you afterwards. And I know that you are a dedicated environmental activist, as we talked about. You've been arrested 5 times for various infractions. Very unlike a lot of other value types, she's willing to walk the talk, as I mentioned before. What was it that set you on your vegan path? Can you give us a little rundown about how that all happened for you?
I don't think that there really is a separation between being what people like to call the ists, you know, an environmentalist, a humanitarian, animal rights, someone who's concerned with the rights of other species, not just animals, but other living things. And I mean, all of these things are interdependent, interconnected. And so, as soon as we start separating those concerns, it's hard for us to relate to it. We start thinking of the environment as something that's outside of ourselves rather than something that is our actual life support system, you know? And so there's no way of being a humanitarian without taking care of those life support systems that we depend upon. There's no way of being a compassionate, ethical being without looking after the other living things on the planet. It's all interdependent. So I always struggle when people refer to me as an environmentalist because I'm like, what? That's not really the case. I fight against issues like slavery just as much as I fight against issues such as mountaintop removal or protecting our water systems So I think all of these things are so much. We all understand that, I think, at a primal and profound level that these concerns are interdependent. But it's something that somehow our intellect is able to make these distinctions. And we define ourselves in these narrow terms. So I just wanted to say that up front. But in terms of being a vegetarian, what started me on that route and then a vegan was that I grew up in Chicago. My mom's from Ohio, from Shaker Heights, and I spent a lot of time in Michigan, so I'm really glad to see so many people here. We used to drive to Wisconsin all the time to visit my grandparents, and there was this overpass diner called the Oasis, which was more like a hellhole in my opinion. I hated it because it was just one of those places where you go and you stand in line with your tray and you get cream crud on crap, not great food. And so I would just, the lighting was neon and bad, and it was just the whole thing was just like, I didn't like it. So I used to beg my parents to not have to go in to the restaurant. And in those days, of course, it wasn't against the law or dangerous really to leave your kid in the car. So my parents were like, okay, you can stay in the car. And after about, half an hour or 45 minutes, I got a little bit bored. Am I talking too fast for you, by the way? Just let me know. Okay. I'm not on crack or anything. There's just a lot to say, so I'll talk fast. So I got a little bit bored, and I started wandering around the parking lot, and I noticed this Mack truck full of baby calves, and they were just so cute. And I remember there was this one that I completely bonded with, and I was just kissing it, and it was kissing me, and I was just like, fell in love. The truck driver came out, and I'm like, 7 years old, right? So I was like, excuse me, sir, what's this one's name? And he goes, Beal, tomorrow morning at 7. And I just, like, that really was that was the motivating force. Like, at that point, I just decided I mean, I didn't even decide, actually. It was, I lost the ability to disassociate the food on my plate from the creature that it had been. And as a kid, you know, that's just not something I was ever, I was in control of anymore. I literally could not see fish stick. I saw the fish, you know, I couldn't gnaw on the hide of another creature. And so it was an emotional decision. I guess a compassionate decision more than it was, wasn't an environmental decision, it wasn't a health decision. It just turns out that it's better for all those things as well. Just like any good choice that we make is, you know, any choice that you make that's better for you or your children is going to be better for every other living thing down the line. It just works out that way. It's so great. And so there's always a cherry on top of every good choice that we make. And so, you know, of course, when I was a kid, my parents weren't thrilled about that, since I have seven sisters and one brother. And my parents, you know, were like, this was going to be a pain in the butt to try to make separate meals for you. So they thought they would dissuade me by not really encouraging it or making different meals. So it took me a really long time to learn about how to eat healthy. So, because, you know, they didn't realize that I was not going to change my ways. I didn't really plan on doing it for the rest of my life, but it just turned out that way. But at the time, I kind of subsisted on junk food. You know, I think I grew up on potato chips and Twinkies and garbage, thinking that that was whatever you put in your mouth was food. And it took me really until my late 20s to learn how to eat a vegetable, because all the vegetables that we had when I was a kid were in cans, and they were really gross. I don't know if you already had canned spinach, but it doesn't, I don't know how Popeye could do it. It was disgusting, you know, it just looked like a barf. So I always told people I was allergic to spinach so I could get out of eating it. Until I actually learned about fresh, actual food that grows out of the ground, and how good it is, and how much protein there is in vegetables, and how everything you need is in a whole food, you know, the enzymes to digest it, the vitamins, the nutrients, if it's grown in healthy soil that is rich with minerals and things. So anyway, that was sort of, it took me a long time to learn about that stuff, but now I'm really glad I know about it, because, you know, I probably would have really thick blonde hair if I'd grown up eating healthier, but, you know, rather than this skimpy little stuff. But I think at least I think I bought myself a few more years by actually starting to eat real food. So anyway, that was sort of my progression into vegetarian and vegan.
What stuff did you take when you went vegan? I mean, what was it that precipitated it, or was it your epiphany, or how that?
Well, I mean, it's just, you know, I mean, for a long time, I mean, I have a bunch of rescue animals, so all of my, I grew up in the 42nd story of the building, and we weren't allowed to have any pets. And I ended up finding a bird, a parakeet, that escaped one side of my building, and I put my finger up to it and it jumped on, and so I'm like, oh great, so I put it on my shoulder, and I took it up in the elevator, I kept it in my room. He lived in my room, flew around, and he'd come and greet people by landing on their head, and of course that kept my mom out of my room, which was great. She was scared, he'd fly out, and she'd be like, oh, he's gonna attack me, the birds. I'm like, no, he just wants to meet you in your head. So as soon as I became more of a grown-up and moved off to go to college and stuff, I started collecting strays, and I have a bunch of rescue critters. So I have horses, alpacas, a pig, chickens, and so the chickens, they ovulate every day. They have eggs every day, whether they're fertilized or not. So for a long time, I ate the eggs of my chickens, you know, and also traded the eggs for some of the my neighbor's goat cheese when their goats were in season. But I guess it wasn't really that big of a step. I just kind of lost the taste. I thought it made my system mucousy and stuff, so I just, oh, that's gross. I know it's a gross word, I'm sorry. But, yeah, someone once told me, after I became an adult, too much dairy, that wasn't from somebody that I knew who made it, because I heard this, is disgusting, so I'm sorry, but I have to tell you. I heard this disgusting story that most commercial milk products, they have to put bleach in them because there's so much pus and blood. And because of especially the cows, their udders get chapped from the machines and stuff, and so there's so much pus and blood that they have to actually bleach them so that it's white. That's gross. So much mucus and gross. It's just, so anyway, you never really do it. So that was sort of the natural step. And yeah, there's so many good options now. I mean, I'm ancient, so when I became vegetarian, there weren't that many good, vegan options, and now there's just incredible options out there, and it's so easy to make, delicious hemp milk and nut milks and stuff like that. I mean, it just takes me 2 seconds. I take a handful of hemp seeds, throw it in the blender, a little bit of agave, and boom, done. It's just delicious.
Well, as an athlete and a firefighter myself, I came under ridicule having switched my diet out, and I lost some weight, and I actually improved my performance, so it didn't take long for others to respect the fact that I had made that choice. And you're right, there's plenty of protein. All of the animals that most people are eating are vegan animals. They're eating plants in order to build protein, and we can do the same thing, and it's very easily done, and most vegetables have plenty of protein for you. No need to supplement.
Yeah, I just look at my horses sometimes, or I just got to go to Kenya for the first time in my life, and I was just marveling at the size of these elephants and giraffes and stuff. They all just eat plants, even the gorillas. When I got to go to Rwanda and the Congo and climb around with the gorillas, giant gorillas and everything. I was not that far away from maybe 10 feet or something like that from a giant silverback, it's a little bit intimidating, but I kept reminding myself, he's a vegetarian, I'm not a vegetarian.
Be sure to take a look at a gorilla, the canine teeth. Everyone says, oh my God, these huge canines, I've got to be eating meat. Take a look at a gorilla. They don't eat meat, and their canines are like huge. It takes a strong person to risk personal injury to help others, yet you have done that on two separate occasions. I understand that you were twice responsible for the capture of muggers in New York City. if you want, you can expound on that, but what other things have you done to stand up for injustice in the world?
That's an interesting thing. I mean, I really think that now, especially, maybe it's always been the case, but I haven't really been alive now, so I don't know, but I just think now, especially, it seems to me, with the way that media is, and how much disinformation there is in the media, that it's really important that we share information with each other, because we can't make wise choices unless we're informed. And it's not like we have to tell each other what to do. We just need to share information. We can look into it and figure out what's best for ourselves. I believe that most people will make healthy choices when they're informed. Most people are not suicidal or murderous. Most people actually just want to have a good life and have their kids have good lives. And so if we're informed, we will make wise decisions. And the media has been so polarizing and so much disinformation, obviously due to the fact that there's so much monetary benefit that comes out of either endorsing certain points of view, but it's against the interests of our survival and our ability to thrive. And so it's really, really, really crucial that we get informed and that we speak out. I think that there, you know, the way that this world has changed for the better has always been through people taking power back into their own hands and coming together and speaking out. You look at any great movement in history, you know, whether it's, you know, women's rights, whether it's anti-apartheid, whether it's civil rights, whether, I mean, any movement has always started with people saying, no, we're going to draw a line in the sand, this is unacceptable. And even just, I was just telling you this morning, I just read, I'm on the board of Dr. Sylvia Earle's foundation called Mission Blue, which is, Dr. Sylvia Earle is one of my all-time heroes, and she has walked, she's the only person who's walked untethered at the bottom of the deepest part of the ocean, and she's the aquanaut, and also spent more time under the ocean than probably any other living person, and the changes in the ocean should be a wake-up call to all of us. It's alarming, the ocean acidification, which is happening. The ocean sequesters the lion's share of our carbon on this planet. The ocean basically through algae, which collects the carbon and sinks to the bottom and holds it there, not permanently, but, you know, temporarily until we dredge the bottom of the ocean, which is a stupid thing to do. It's like basically strip mining the bottom of the ocean just to get a few different fish species. But what's been happening is we've been pouring so much carbon into the atmosphere through our unsustainable practices, our fossil fuel exploitation, and our agricultural practices, which is what I would really like to talk about, the agriculture side of things. But that the ocean has been sequestering so much that it's become more acidic. Now, the good thing about, I don't know if you can call it a good thing, but the sort of easy thing to understand about ocean acidification is that it's just a simple pH test. It's not a debatable issue. It's a, you know, it's a pH strip. You go, oh, wow, the ocean's 30% more acid than it's ever been. And the problem with that is that the very base of the food chain includes these little things called pteropods. And pteropods are like, they're like calcifications, like our fingernail, you know, like these thin calcifications that sort of fly around like little butterflies. And they're the bottom of the food chain. So, you know, little crustaceans will eat them, and then the fish will eat the crustaceans, and, you know, so on and so forth. So the bottom of the food chain, including corals and these pteropods, cannot form their body parts when the ocean is acid. And so we are endangering the entire food chain by pouring this carbon into the atmosphere. Well, this is incredibly, incredibly alarming. Well, so we need to start, you know, sort of making ourselves aware of these things and actually start shifting our practices to practices that we already have the ability to do and practices that make sense. So back to the good news that I was telling you about this morning is that I just read on Sylvia's website. She has an organization called Mission Blue, and she works to create hope spots in the ocean. So she raises money to save parts of the ocean which are to be preserved as no-take zones. So they're not allowed to, you're not allowed to fish, you're not allowed to dredge, you're not allowed to, you're supposed to be saved so that they can perform their natural services that they do that help keep us alive as well as other species. She calls them the blue lungs of our planet. Well, one of the good bits of news, because of people getting informed, people spreading information, and people speaking out, is that just this morning it was announced that 90% of the shark fin imports to Hong Kong have decreased. 90%. I mean, that's not. Very short period of time. this is a sea change, you know, and that's all related to awareness and all related to people speaking out and taking action. And I can't stress how important it is. I mean, we are at a crisis on every level. We're in the middle of a climate crisis. We're in the middle of an economic crisis. We're in the middle of a fresh water crisis. We have an extinction crisis, and that's another, you know, we're an overpopulation crisis. We're facing so many different crises, and yet, we have a slavery crisis. There's more slaves now than any other time in human history. We have the solution to all of these crises at our disposal, and we are not employing them because of what I believe, because it's a lack of information. And once we have that information, we will start insisting upon us taking advantage of it. We will stop allowing the corruption that goes on in our political and legislative systems. There was just a Supreme Court ruling that passed a week ago. I'm shocked that there isn't a revolution about it. It was called the MacArthur Amendment. It weakened the Citizens United ruling that happened in 2010 even further, which was also a ruling that should have been a call to arms because it was so shocking. It basically gives unlimited amounts of money to corporations to give to the politicians, and that means also to the legislators, which means that one vote, one person is no longer the case. We think we live in a democracy, we live in a corporatocracy now, and that's for sure. And that's absolutely unacceptable. That's not the country that any of us ever intended to live in, want to live in, and it's absolutely unacceptable, and we need to change that system. But in the meantime, we can make change from the bottom up. We don't have to wait for Daddy to tell us it's okay. We don't have to wait for, you know, someone to say, oh, we're going to change these rules and these laws. But certainly, it's not going to happen when all the money's coming from the corporate interests. So it's time for us to start taking our power back and start drawing the line in the sand.
Absolutely. You have clearly demonstrated that you're a person of action. And on a personal level, what are you doing to help stem the tide of environmental crisis we're facing on the planet, like, for instance, your home and your personal travel and that kind of thing?
I always think it's hard, you know, to be a purist. And, I mean, I don't think that it's a good idea to really, I mean, it's a good idea to have to have ideals and to have goals, but it's also sort of ludicrous to think that any of us can exist without being somewhat hypocritical to a certain extent. I mean, I flew here, obviously, so I use fossil fuels at times, but when I do the best I can, and that's all any of us can and should do. We should do the best that we can. I've been off the grid, which means my house has been on solar power for about 25 years, and it works. The great news is, you know, it works, and not only that, it paid for itself after the first 5 years, so basically I've been providing free energy for myself for about 20 years. So I encourage any of you who can afford to either augment or get yourselves, you know, on solar power, even in Detroit, and it's possible, it's doable, and it works. I mean, even when it's, you know, not sunny, even my system has a battery backup system, so when it's not sunny, it stores energy. I mean, I've had it for 25 years. Like I said, I have a backup generator that I run on biodiesel, but it's never run down, so I've never had to use the backup generator. My vehicles have the Kill Bill Trans Am. I run that on alcohol fuel. That car was in 1979, so it's not a fuel-injected car. But here's another one of the best-kept street secrets on the planet, is that any fuel-injected car is a flex-fuel vehicle. And a flex-fuel vehicle doesn't mean that it can only run it. Flex-fuel means that cars are warranted to run on 85% alcohol fuel, right, or ethanol. And ethanol First of all, alcohol grown at home does not have to be made from corn and should not be made from corn. It's not the most productive crop to make alcohol fuel out of. In fact, alcohol fuel can be made of any starchy or sugary substance. You know, everybody in there and their, you know, hillbilly brother had a still in their backyard back in the 1800s. Alcohol's not that hard to make, you know. You make it from rotten apples, you make it from day-old bread, you can make it from cattails that are grown by remediating sewage. And waste happens to be the best source of biofuels. And that's what I run my vehicles on. So my car, since it was 1979, is not fuel injected. So to shift it to be a flexible vehicle, meaning I run it on 100% alcohol, was a little bit more complicated. But any car that's a flex fuel vehicle, which means every single car that's pretty much on the road since the 80s, is a flex fuel vehicle. It just needs a tiny little box, a modification that can be put in under 5 minutes by any mechanic. It doesn't have to be like an obvious specialized auto mechanic. That tells your carburetor what fuel it's running on. And then you can have a car that runs on alcohol fuel. So we don't need everybody in the world to buy an electric car and be sitting on a bank of batteries and getting all those EMFs, you know, to put your kids on or whatever. We don't need we need more. You know, every new car should be hyper efficient, and there are already engines that exist that we should be taking advantage of that are far, far more efficient and burner clean. But we certainly don't need to reinvent all of our infrastructure, which would be incredibly wasteful, just to get off petroleum and to have cars that don't put out greenhouse gases. Any diesel engine, Rudolph Diesel invented the diesel engine to run on peanut oil so that farmers could grow their own fuel. Then he was found floating in the English Channel a few years later. And the petroleum industry took his engine and modified it to run on this toxic byproduct of petroleum, which they call diesel. If he'd have known they named that fuel after him, he would have rolled over in his grave. But I also run my diesel El Camino on biodiesel, and which is also made from waste from fast food restaurants. And then I have a switch in there, so I have a dual tank, and it can also burn straight veggie oil because I managed to get about 1,500 gallons of hemp oil from a woman who had been planning to make some body care products, but she didn't pay her refrigeration bills, so it went rancid. She couldn't use it for body care products, but it's perfect for fuel. I think the biofuels, you know, the petroleum industry, when the biofuels industry had a surge of interest, petroleum industry did its best to kill it. They killed a lot of the initial plants, got the economy to fail to a certain extent, so that they ended up buying all the ethanol plants around the country themselves. But also the biofuel industry there was a lot of misinformation put out about the food versus fuel crisis, which didn't really exist. But biofuels shouldn't be made from food. They shouldn't be made from cutting down rainforests to grow palm oil. In fact, palm oil or biodiesel gels when it comes over here. Biofuels should be made from whatever you have that's waste in your region, as should any energy, as all energy, all sustainability is based on a model of regional development. So, you know, the idea of replacing a giant electrical grid system with a giant solar system is not sustainable. The idea of, you know, these giant monocropped farms, you know, GMO monocropped farms, and replacing them with giant organic farms, that's not sustainable. I was listening to, there's an investment expert named Tom Steyer, who's done very well by himself, he's a billionaire or something, but he was speaking the other day. He's actually looking at fighting the climate crisis through the political system, which I don't have very much faith in. But he spent quite a bit of money doing some polls and some research so he could figure out how he could be most effective. And he learned a very interesting thing, which was that we are, as a species, motivated quite often by crises. We were talking about this earlier, which is unfortunate, because a lot of times when things get to a crisis, you know, it's already too late. People have already been harmed or damaged. But he was saying that what was really interesting, they were doing some studies to see if people were motivated by Hurricane Sandy or Hurricane Katrina or some of the droughts that they're experiencing in the heartland of our country to act on climate. And he found that, in fact, that wasn't the case unless you lived in those areas. If you lived in New York during Hurricane Sandy, then you're motivated to act on climate. But if you lived in San Francisco, you were like, oh, I feel really bad for those people, but, you know, everything's okay in San Francisco. Let's keep going, you know. So, so what that showed me, which I thought was, it sort of put the pieces together for me, because regional, decentralized energy, locally grown food, all these things are the things that make the most sense in terms of resilience, national security, if you want to put it that way, and sustainability, or whatever the word that you like is, you know, maybe that's how things function the best and are the most resilient, right? I'm trying to go, you know, well, look at Hurricane Sandy, you know, we've got to do something, we've got to be strong for our climate. That's not the way it works, because you don't, you have to look at what are the issues that are affecting San Francisco? What are the issues that are affecting Detroit? What are the issues that are, you know, and also build the resilience regionally as well. And that's the way that things should be done anyway. So I thought that was a really interesting revelation, and I was actually quite inspired by it, even though initially, you know, you think that you would be depressed by the fact that people weren't motivated, but I think quite the opposite. I think it's an exciting revelation, because we always like to think we have a couple weaknesses as a species. We have Achilles' heel, which is, you know, that we're addicted to instant gratification. You know, we like that. You know, like, well, you know, the First Nations and Native American communities always think, you know, long term, right? They'll think seven generations, you know, okay, before I make this choice, how is it going to affect my children and my children's children, my children's children's children, seven times, right? So, but we have been brought up in, you know, at least since the Industrial Revolution, to be addicted to instant gratification. And I think that's a hard one, you know. But it's something that we can get over once we realize that it's just not in our best interest. And I think the other one is that, you know, we end up waiting until, you know, things are already really bad to take action. And so it's such a weird thing. We're such a funny, strange species. I mean, you know, why would we not do something that was in our best interest? We've been given the ability to think about the actions, the ramifications of our actions. We have the ability to project into the future and think about what are the consequences of our actions. We've got to start taking advantage of that more.
Since this is the VegFest, I think I'd like to bring up the fact that this probably the single most important thing that anyone can do in this room or anywhere is to switch to a plant-based diet. It affects so many different things in our lives and on the planet level. So do a little research on that, and you'll discover some surprising facts and figures. So.
You know, my brother, I don't know if he'll be mad at me for sharing this, but I'm going to share it anyway. I'll take the consequences. He can give me a noogie or something. But my brother had a quintuple bypass. And my brother's like a superhero. I mean, he's like an X Games athlete. He kite surfs, he base jumps, he skydives. He has Guinness Book of World Records skydiving thing. He's like, you know, most people naked at midnight jumping on planes. he's incredibly fit, incredibly athletic, like just an amazing guy. And he had to have a quintuple bypass. And I, you know, of course, I've been on his case forever to become vegetarian. Of course, you know, my family's the last one ever to listen to you. That's just the way it is. I don't know. But,
but anyway, he wouldn't pay attention, He had his quintuple bypass, and this is the absolute truth. They put, first of all, they put something like antifreeze in your heart so they have to stop it. And, you know, they take out these veins from your legs in order to put the quintuple is the most you can have, right? There's no more parts to pass, to bypass. He gets back into his hospital room, and they called his hospital room, right? He's already spinning out on morphine, and they called his hospital room and asked him if he wanted steak for dinner that night. Absolute truth. And if I wasn't in the room to say no, he was going to say yes. Because, you know, my brother's like a big meat-eating boy, right? And he would have said yes, because he was on morphine. He didn't know that he couldn't have steak after he had a quintuple bypass surgery. Of course, the whole time he was in the hospital, it was kind of my opportunity, because he couldn't get out of bed. Bringing him, green smoothies and juices and salads and feeding all the stuff. And, he got into it, but certainly as soon as he got out of the hospital, he went back to his regular habits, and he had to have another stent put in. And that freaked him out. I mean, if the quintuple bypass didn't bring him out, but anyway, so that freaked him out. Finally, he watched that film I've been telling him about for years, The Forks Over Knives. I don't know if you've seen that documentary.
Watching the Freeman, by the way, on Google.com.
Yeah, which
or you can get it through Netflix.
Yeah, check it out. Share it on your social media. Share it with your friends. But it's. That's one of the statistics, I'm sure many of you already know it, but, the leading cause of disease in the United States is heart disease. The leading prescription medicine in the United States is Lipitor. And it's the most unnecessary medicine in the United States. Heart disease is preventable by switching to a plant-based diet.
Reversible.
And so my brother is now on the good path, and he is thrilled, and now he's become a bigger evangelist than me. That's us waiting till we're in a crisis, and it's just, what is up there? I mean, I'm blonde, but I'm not that one.
Incidentally, former President Bill Clinton, probably the most famous vegan on the planet now, experienced many of the same issues that your brother had, and now he's singing the praises of plant-based nutrition, and he's lost 30 pounds, and he can't say enough about it. So it's an incredible thing what can happen to you, what your body is capable of doing when it's got the right nutrition to heal itself.
It's also I have all these rescue animals, and I have a pig named Molly. And she was, she's a rescue from, she's a micro mini, or supposed to be a micro mini, by the way, she's microchipped and fancy, blah, blah, blah. Well, she was at a new home every 2 weeks of her life for the first 9 months that she existed. And she was, I guess, a Beverly Hills lady's pocket pig, like they thought they'd have a pig in there first instead of a chihuahua. So my sister has a camp for kids with terminal illnesses, cost-free year-round camp called the Painted Turtle. It's amazing. Check it out. But anyway, so my sister had won Molly in an auction thought she would, have her at the camp for the kids to, pet and get to know, but it turned out there were too many health concerns or something, so I'm always the drop-off stop for any unwanted creatures. And so Molly came to live with me. I never had a pig before. And first I did some research online and I found out there's no such thing as a micro mini. People keep their pigs small by feeding them only one cup a day, which basically starves them. So their organs will continue to grow, but their body doesn't. So within 5 years or even less, they'll die. Whereas their natural lifespan is about the same as a big dog, like 15 years, something like that. And they'll grow to about 150 pounds or 200 or so. So I'm always a big pig now. But it's been really interesting to get to know a pig. I mean, I've
I've been pigs before, I've met them at an animal sanctuary or whatever, but I've never actually lived with a pig, or slept with a pig. Molly sleeps in the house, she sleeps with the dogs in the house. Pigs are very clean. They like, or she likes to be clean. She really, they only use mud as a sunblock, because they have skin like us, you know, they burn easily and stuff. And they don't have much hair, you know, and they're really interesting characters, because first of all, they say that pigs are as smart as a 3-year-old child. I mean, Molly, at 9 months, she already knew a whole bunch of stuff. Like, she was already clear that how it's broken, and I got her, she knew all these tricks. She would stand around and fight it before, she would kiss me on, you know, whatever, all these different things. But you know, they're funny because they don't have, like, everything wants to eat them. Everything. And so if you pet them on the top of their body, they kind of get scared because they think you're going to eat them, and they can't see up there because their eyes are under their back down here, you know. And so they like to be petted underneath. They get grumpy because it's their only defense mechanism, you know. They don't really have, like, fangs or claws or anything, so grumpy is their go-to, you know, sort of no signal, you know. But, you know, and then plus that's their voice. Their voice sounds grumpy, you know. But she has a baby voice too, and she's really happy. She speaks in her little, you know, really high-pitched grunt. You know, it's like very. But she's like, it's been so interesting to get to know a creature like that. And now I see or hear of, you know, pigs. Or, you know, obviously I don't want to get into it, deep into it, because I'm sure you all are aware of the industrial husbandry system that we have that is so inhumane in this country. But it just kills me when it always made me ill, of course, to see how inhumane we were to other creatures. Especially that in our food industry, I mean, who would want to eat all those hormones that are released when these animals are terrified, you know? But on top of it, knowing this pig so well now, and seeing how aware she is of everything, I mean, really everything, you know? Because she understands if I'm not feeling good, if I'm feeling sad or down, she'll, like, come over and kiss me. When I come home and I've been out of town, she just comes and licks my face for, like, half an hour, and then, like, 30 minutes later, she's grumpy with me if I tell her to go outside and it's raining. She hates the cold, doesn't like to go out and rain. You know, she is just, I can't even bear the way that, the thought that we, you know, force these creatures into these horrible situations. I mean, of course, we do it to each other as well, which is also unbelievable. Like, it's just, I just think we're made of better stuff than, you know, the worst part of our nature is, it's just, we have to, we have to rise above the dark side. You know, we just have, we all have both sides within us, you know. But we have to rise above it. And I really believe that we all have a desire to just be decent, you know, and have a good life. And I think that the. But there's a famous line, of course, I'm not going to remember it, but it was a famous line from Tolstoy, it was a famous line from, you know, all the great philosophers who talk about the very first step in compassion is being compassionate to another creature, you know, is the first step of our evolution of compassion. And that's what I kind of realized, that activism, if you want to call that, but it's another ism, or advocacy, or sharing information, speaking out is when you get overwhelmed by that feeling of compassion that you have to take action, that you have to stand in solidarity, that you have to speak out. It's almost not a choice. But it also is a choice. Like, I don't want to disempower myself or others by saying that it isn't a choice. It's a motivator. But it's also saying I'm going to to risk arrest, or I'm going to risk putting myself out there and feeling uncomfortable even though, like, speaking in front of people is not in my nature, I'm very, very shy and, like, adorably awkward, but I feel that there's something more important than my butterflies in my stomach or, you know, the fact that I might make a fool of myself. There are more important things, especially in these times of crisis. We all need to rise above and elevate our better selves and get out there and speak out for whatever moves us, whatever we're passionate and compassionate about. We need, you know, we all have, you know, my mom used to say, because I was a really skinny, dorky kid, that you're special, you know. And I know that that's like a, you know, a sort of cliche thing, but it's so true. Everybody has a unique gift that only they can connect to and share with the world. And it's incumbent upon us all to do that, to reach down and think about what it is that moves us, what it is that we specifically are connected to, and what talents we have to bring out, and to share them in order to motivate your neighbors, your relatives, your friends, your community, whoever you can motivate to make this world a better place.
Up a little bit in the end and ask you what your favorite, some of your favorite vegan foods are. Do you prepare your own too?
Well, I like I said, I do like to make hemp milk because it's fast and delicious and highest essential fatty acids of any living food source, so that's an awesome one. You know, I go through phases. I was eating a lot of kale until I found out that my thyroid is a little funky, and kale is not the best thing for thyroid stuff. So if
you eat it steamed or cooked, it's much better.
Yes, so now, but I'm eating, you know, I mean, I kind of go in phases and switch it up. There is something I was mentioning to you earlier this morning. A lot of vegetarians will use mushrooms as a meat substitute, so I just want to give you a little heads up on something a lot of vegans and vegetarians aren't aware of, that button mushrooms, which are the primitives and the portobellos, and they're in the button family, but mushrooms, are carcinogenic. Unless they're cooked over 415 degrees for a certain period of time. And it's important to know that because they're only as carcinogenic as a cigarette, but instead of causing tumors in just your lungs and your mouth, they'll cause them all over your body. And so cumulatively, they are cancer-causing. And so there are other mushrooms, shiitakes, chinis, I mean, almost every other mushroom that's edible other mushrooms are medicinal and fight cancer or regrow brain neurons or fight against breast cancer, maitake, turkey tail, all these ones are cancer fighting. So you know, it's important, that's another thing important to share information about, because a lot of times people will just use mushrooms really heavily, and it's important to know that if you're going to use buttons, make sure you cook them over 415 degrees. But there's a whole host of foods that I like. I'm not too persnickety.
Well, that brings us to the end of our interview, and I want to thank you, Daryl, for coming out to Michigan. And
I'm so,
home.
So happy to see so many people. And I love you, Detroit. You guys have been on the forefront of the herb gardening movement. You guys rock, and I love you so much.